Be free. Be free to live for the Lord. Be free to be free to be joyful. Be free to have joy and peace and that operating in your spirit. Be free in Jesus' name. Glory to God. Hallelujah. The Bible says that Jesus came that we might be free. Glory to God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Well, shout it out. You know that song, Tina? Where you praise God. Hallelujah. Father, we just thank you for who you are and what you're doing in our life today. Lord God, you said in the presence of the Lord is fullness of joy, full of glory. Hallelujah. Thank you for it in Jesus' name. 2 Corinthians chapter 12, if you would, this morning. Ooh. Let's get glad. Let's don't get mad, huh? We'll stir up. We'll kick a few of them religious horses. Don't get mad. Get glad in the presence of the Lord. It's kind of like the story of the guy who went up to his boss and said, I'd like to work extra today. And he said, well, you know I can't afford to pay you any overtime. He said, I'm not asking to get paid overtime. I just don't want to go home yet. I'm in the doghouse at the house. I ain't ready to go home. He said, what did you do? He said, I don't know. He goes, I didn't really do anything. Just one of them woman things, I guess. I don't know. He said, all I know is I was just sitting there watching TV, and she came in and said, what's on the TV? And I just looked at her and said, dust. And she got mad. Oh, don't get mad this morning. Get glad in Jesus' name. Chapter 12, are you there?
Amen.
Verse 1, Paul says, it's not expedient for me, doubtless, to glory. I will come to visions and revelations of the Lord. I like that right there. Paul's a confident man. You know, Paul said, right, what he basically said was, look, it's not to my advantage to brag. However, I will have visions. I will have revelation from the Lord. That was Paul's confession. Paul believed that. I believe that too. Not just for Paul, I'm talking about for Tommy. Amen. I will. Amen. I will. I'm not bragging on myself. I'm bragging on him, the Lord. I will have visions. Oh, it was the Holy Ghost idea to pray for me that the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ would give unto me the spirit of what? Wisdom and revelation in the knowledge of him. The eyes of my understanding would be enlightened, that I might know some things. Glory to God. I will, like Paul said, I will, hallelujah, come to visions and revelations of the Lord. Verse 2, and I knew a man in Christ above 14 years ago, whether in the body I cannot tell, or whether out of the body I cannot tell. God knows. Such a one called up to the third heaven. And I knew such a man, whether in the body or out of the body, I cannot tell. God knows. How that he was called up into paradise and heard unspeakable words, which it is not lawful for a man to utter. Of such a one will I glory, yet of myself I will not glory, but in my infirmities or in my weaknesses. For though I would desire to glory, I shall not be a fool, for I will say the truth. But now I forbear, lest any man should think of me above that which he seeth me to be, or that he heareth of me, and lest I should be exalted above measure through the abundance of the revelations. There was given to me a thorn in the flesh, the messenger of Satan, to buffet me, to torment me, lest I should be exalted above measure. And for this thing I besought the Lord thrice, that it might depart from me. And he said unto me, my grace is sufficient for thee. Say that with me. My grace is sufficient for thee. For my strength is made perfect in weakness. Most gladly, therefore, would I rather glory in my infirmities or in my weaknesses, that the power of Christ may rest upon me. Therefore I take pleasure in infirmities, in reproaches, in necessities, in persecutions, in distresses for Christ's sake. For when I'm weak, then I'm strong. Father, I thank you today. You said that the poor say that I'm rich. Not that we would just be lying, but you said that you would supply all our needs according to your riches and glory. You said that the weak say, I am strong. Not that you've ever told one person to say something that wasn't true. What you're saying is that in our joy, the joy of the Lord makes me strong. In the presence of the Lord, I'm strong. In my weaknesses, your strength is manifest. So we can say with boldness, when I'm weak, I'm strong. So Father, I thank you today for ears to hear. fresh anointing in this place. A fresh anointing on this church, Lord God. A fresh filling today in Jesus' name. Glory to God. Can you receive that, people? Can you receive that? The Bible says, Ephesians chapter 5, to be being filled, to continually receive a fresh anointing today. And glory to God. And I hope to be clear today, as clear as I feel like the Lord laid this on my heart just at the end of the week. And I've been trying to pin it in such a way, to get it inside of me in such a way that I could communicate it with great clarity so that we could all be partakers of the word of the Lord this morning. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. Paul said here, the interesting passage right here, one of the things that you hear people talk about when you read a passage like this is verse 7, where Paul said, lest I should be exalted above measure through the abundance of the revelations, there was given to me a thorn in the flesh. And church, over the years, I have heard all kinds of things about what this thorn in the flesh was, could have been. Some would say sickness. Some would say he is having vision problems or some kind of disease. I don't know. Perhaps they know more than I know. I'm just telling you what the scripture says today. It says he was given a thorn in the flesh, the messenger of Satan. Okay, that's what the Bible says that he was given. The messenger of Satan. And of course, that word messenger is the same word that's translated angel 179 times in your Bible. Okay, so what Paul said that this thorn in the flesh was, what the scriptures say is that it was a demonic angel is what it was. Okay, it was a messenger from Satan. It was a demonic angel sent to torment Paul. And the Bible tells us why, okay? It tells us why. It says, let me just go back to verse 6, what Paul says. He says, for though I would desire to glory, I shall not be a fool, for I will say the truth. In other words, Paul says, I could brag, but if I was bragging, I'd just be telling the truth. But now I resist. Lest any man should think of me above that which he seeth me to be, or that he heareth of me. And lest I should be exalted above measure through the abundance of the revelation, there was given unto me a thorn in the flesh, the messenger of Satan, to buffet me, lest I should be exalted above measure. Now understand what Paul was saying, why the devil sent this demonic angel his way. It wasn't that Paul had a pride issue. He wasn't saying, lest I be exalted. We just read it. He said, lest men think of me higher than they ought to. Lest I be exalted in their eyes more than I should be. Okay? Paul was getting revelation. Amen? Paul was getting revelation. If the Lord didn't want him to have revelation, he could have stopped giving it to him. He didn't have to. Y'all understand what I'm saying? For this thing I besought the Lord thrice in it, that it might depart from me. And the Lord answered him. He said, my grace, somebody say grace, is sufficient for thee, for my strength, somebody say strength, is made perfect in weakness. Notice the Lord connects his grace with his strength. Friend, when you receive the grace of God, you are receiving the strength of God, okay? Grace is defined as unmerited favor, and how we understand it certainly is. Glory to God. Ephesians 2:8, you have been saved by grace through faith, that not of yourself. It is the gift of God. Amen?
Amen.
It's the gift of God, that not of works, that any man should boast. It is, grace is a gift. Faith is a gift. Amen? You can't earn God's grace. Titus 2:11 says that for the grace of God that brings salvation has appeared to all men. You can't earn. It's not earned. That's why it's not of works that any man can boast. Okay? It's certainly not deserved. Can I get a witness in here today? I can't speak for you. I can't speak for myself. However, I certainly don't deserve it. It's unmerited. Okay? It can only be received by faith. Now, let me say this. Some people teach grace in such a way as to almost practically eliminate faith. That is, well, it has nothing to do on your part. It's just God's doing everything. That's not true. The only way grace can be received is by faith. It takes faith to access God's grace. Grace is most certainly unmerited favor, but that's not all grace is. Can I tell you this morning, church? The grace of God is the very strength, the very power, his very ability. Amen. Glory to God. Freely offered to you. The very strength of God is the grace of God. The very power of God, his very ability, freely offered to you. That's what the grace of God is. Which will enable you, church, to overcome every situation you will ever find yourself in. Hello? The grace of God will enable you to overcome every situation you will ever find yourself in. And we, church, it's amazing to me. It's amazing grace, amen, like we say, that we can appropriate all God has, all God is, amen, His grace by faith. How does faith come? Amen. Oh, by hearing it. Glory to God. How do you think that when the centurion who heard, when he heard Jesus, he recognized authority. And he said, what did he say about concerning his sick servant? He said, you don't even need to come. You just send your word. And what did Jesus say? I haven't found faith like this. So it's a great faith in all of Israel. The woman who had just heard with the issue of blood, who had just heard of Jesus, she said in her heart, if I but touch the hem of his garment, I could be made whole. Glory to God. And he said, thy faith has healed thee. Her faith grabbed hold of the power of God. He said, my grace is sufficient for you, Paul. Hallelujah. God's grace is sufficient. As a matter of fact, it's enough. As a matter of fact, it's more than enough. Amen. To cause you to always triumph in life. Amen. How many believe it takes faith to believe that? But that's what the Word of God says. Paul said, what? Paul believed it because after he said, verse 9, after the Lord said, my grace is sufficient for thee, for my strength is made perfect in weakness. Look what Paul says. Most gladly, therefore, will I rather glory in my weaknesses that the power of God, the grace of God may rest on me. Hallelujah. Acts chapter 4, verse 33 says, and with great power gave the apostles witness of the resurrection of the Lord Jesus, and great grace was upon them all. Notice great power connected to great grace. 2 Timothy 2:1 says, therefore, my son, be strong in the grace that is in Christ Jesus. Be strong in the what? In the grace that is in who? Oh, in Christ. Let me say this, okay? That the only way any believer can be strong, okay, is by the grace that is found in Christ Jesus. Can you hear me this morning? That's total dependence on Jesus. Total dependence on the Lord. Hallelujah. 2 Corinthians 9:8. God is able to make all grace abound towards you, that ye always, having all sufficiency in all things, may abound to every good work. I'm telling you that the Bible tells us very clearly that it's God's desire that we always have all sufficiency in all things. Amen. And he tells us it's the grace of God that accomplishes that in our lives. Can you say amen?
Amen.
So what the Lord was telling Paul in verse 9, when he said, my grace is sufficient for thee, he was saying, use it. Somebody say, use it.
Use
it. Use the power and ability that God has already provided him to deal with this thorn in the flesh, to deal with this demon angel tormenting him. Use the power you already have, Paul. You don't have to pray about this. Go into action. Can you say amen? There's things that people are praying about, praying for God to do, that God already told you to do. God already gave you the ability to take care of. And God doesn't do for you what he's already told you to do for yourself. Hello? Paul, that God wasn't going to remove this thorn from his flesh. He already gave Paul the ability to remove the thorn from his flesh. Okay? To deal with this situation. And he wasn't telling Paul, well, you know, just suffer through this demonic attack. He's never told anybody that. I don't know why people preach that. My grace is sufficient for you. Just you'll be okay. Just endure. He's never told anybody to suffer through a demonic attack. You know, God won't put on you more than you can handle. Jesus never told Paul that. You know why he would never say that? Because that's not even a scripture. He's never said that to anybody. Oh, I know someone said, but ain't that in the Bible? Isn't that in the Bible? No, it's not. Nowhere in the Bible does it say, God won't put on you more than you can handle. It's one of them half-truths that people walk around claiming for themselves and trying to stand on. But God said, I'll confirm my word, not something that I never said. They get confused. There is a verse that says God won't allow you to be tempted above that which you can't withstand. But it says nothing about he won't put on you more than you can handle. I always think when a temptation comes my way, I know I can deal with that because God wouldn't even allow it to come my way if I couldn't. And that's you too. What is scripture, however, is Mark 16, 17. These signs shall follow them that believe. They shall cast out devils. That is scripture. Hello? What is scripture is Luke 10, 19, where Jesus said, "Behold, I give you power to tread on serpents and scorpions and over all the power of the enemy, and nothing shall by any means harm you." That is scripture. Paul didn't need to keep asking God to do something for him that God already equipped Paul to do for himself. The Bible tells us Paul was being tormented, attacked by this messenger of Satan because you understand there's an enemy out there. Paul was receiving revelation. You understand that the very things this devil was attacking him about is some of the very things we're reading today. Same things he was saying to them, he's saying to us. And the devil doesn't like that. He didn't like it then, he doesn't like it now. Help me understand there's an enemy. Jesus said, "The thief cometh not, but to steal, kill, and destroy." So understand, the thief, the devil, the serpent, that liar, the accuser, the deceiver, he cometh not but to kill, steal, and destroy. He doesn't come to be your friend. He doesn't come to help you out in your time of need. He doesn't come to alleviate you of some pressures in life. He comes to steal, kill, and destroy. I'm pretty sure most people do not believe that. I'm talking about in the church. Why would you say that, preacher? Because I hear people all the time blaming God for things that are killing, stealing, and destroying their life. They're blaming God. I hear people all the time, doubting God, putting the blame on him for all the devilish activity going on in their life. It's not God doing it. Jesus said, "The thief cometh not but to steal, kill, and destroy, but I've come that you might have life." Can somebody say amen? Amen. And that more abundantly. Church, has not the devil been defeated?
Amen.
Come on. I told you earlier, Acts 10:38, how God anointed Jesus Christ of Nazareth with the Holy Ghost and power, and he went about doing good, healing all who were oppressed of the devil. That's what Jesus does. 1 John 3:8, "For this purpose was the Son of God manifested, that he might destroy the works of the devil." I'm talking about the devil. I'm talking about death, hell, the grave. Amen. Jesus has defeated them all.
Amen.
Woo!
Thank you, Lord.
Hallelujah. And the Bible says, "You are more than a conqueror through him that loved us." The Bible says, "No weapon formed against you shall prosper." Thanks be unto God who always causes me to triumph in Christ. Hey! Makes me want to shout. Throw my hands up and shout. Come on now. Now I understand, and I hope you understand, we presently live in a fallen world, okay? Sin has affected every aspect of this world we live in, okay? Since sin was introduced way back in Genesis chapter 3. Remember, man sinned, and God said one of the things that was going to be a result of sin, that the earth would be cursed, the ground would be cursed because of it, okay? In other words, God didn't create things to be like they are today. They became like this because of sin. Right? He didn't create it that way. It became that way. Romans 8 tells us that creation itself, okay, is groaning and suffering until the sons of God be made manifest. Until this thing ends, creation itself is suffering. It's groaning, okay? Someone said one time that nature sings in a minor key. I thought that was interesting. I don't know how much truth is to that. But he said, "Yeah, anybody, if you know major and minor keys sound always kind of what, Tina?
Sad.
They kind of sound, a minor key always, whatever key it is, if it's minor, it kind of sounds sad. Like when wind blows through the trees, it's kind of, and when surf breaks on the shore, it's kind of." Glory to God. Things happen in this life, in this world, I should say. Bad things happen in this present world, or this present age, we could say. But it's not God, it's not Jesus who's doing it, okay, who's behind it. It's Satan. Hello? The God of this world, the God of this present age, 2 Corinthians 4:4. Jesus called him the prince of this world, John 12:31. And let me say this, it's not God who's allowing him to do these things, all this bad that's going on. I know some people think that, well, yes, the devil can only do what God allows him to do. That's not true. The devil can only do or continue to do in your life what you allow him to do. Somebody help me. Amen. He can only continue to do in your life what you allow him to do. God never said he would insulate you from every bad thing that was taking place in this world. He never said that. He never said that he would keep you from being attacked by the enemy. That he would sovereignly of his own just stop all that stuff. What he has done through the shed blood of Jesus and your faith in it is giving you the power to overcome all that stuff though. Amen. Woo! Amen. That's what he has done. Giving you the grace of God. My grace is sufficient for you. Use it. It'd be like you calling me, asking me for a ride to work when there's a car full of gas that runs just fine sitting in your driveway. You know what I'm going to say? Use it. You have a way to work. My grace is sufficient for you. You have exactly what you need to overcome, church, every situation, every heartache, every bombshell, everything you'll ever face. Hey, that's some good news, friend. Hallelujah. You may be thinking, that is some good news indeed. But how do I access all this power? How do I access this grace so that I can overcome, so I can be victorious? You may be asking that, and I'm glad you asked. If you would, glory to God. The Bible tells us how. The Word of God. It's all in here. Jesus tells us everything we need to know to walk in the grace of God, to operate in the very power in God's very His very divine ability flowing through us, amen. His very, that manifested in your life, right here, all of it. Watch this. 2 Peter, chapter 1. I can quote it to you. Y'all know this is one of my verses, but I want you to look at it. 2 Peter. Chapter 1, verse 2 says, grace and peace be multiplied unto you through the knowledge of God. What do you reckon is the knowledge of God? Would you say the Word of God?
I would.
Grace and peace. How is grace and peace going to be multiplied to you? Through the Word. Amen. How is the power of God, the ability of God, that unmerited favor going to be multiplied in your life? Through the Word. Through the knowledge of God and of Jesus our Lord, according, or because we could even say, as His divine power has given unto us all things pertaining unto life and godliness through the knowledge of Him, through the Word, through knowing about Jesus. As His divine power has given unto us all things pertaining to life and godliness through the knowledge of Him that has called us, amen, the glory to God, that has called us by glory and virtue. Grace is multiplied in your life through the Word. The divine power of God is manifest in your life through the knowledge of God, through the Word of God. Can y'all hear me? Amen. Whereby are given unto us exceedingly great and precious promises, that by these great and precious promises, we may be partakers of His divine nature, that we may have His very ability, His very power operating through us in this life. Woo! What gives us knowledge of Him? The what? The Word. Friend, I'm telling you, everything you know or everything you believe about Him, about Jesus, better be grounded in the Word of God. Y'all hear me? As a matter of fact, let me say this. Everything you, born-again believer, believe about yourself, know about yourself, better be grounded in this Word right here. Can somebody say amen?
Amen.
As a born-again believer, this is what describes you, new creation. Not the world, not some label, not what man wants to put on you, but what this Word says about you. Everything you believe about Jesus, you better be able to point to it in the Scripture. And everything you believe about yourself, Christian, you better be able to point to in the Scripture. What does it say about me? The Bible says, John chapter 1, verse 17, for the law was given by Moses, but grace and truth came by Jesus Christ. The Bible says in John 1:14 that the Word became flesh, dwelt among us. Talk about Jesus. The Word of God became embodied in the person of Jesus Christ. Hallelujah. Do you realize when you say, I'm trusting in Jesus, how many are in here trusting in Jesus this morning? What you're actually saying is, I'm trusting in the Word. Do you realize that? That's what you're saying, the same thing. When you call on Jesus, do you know what you're really calling on? The Word. Have you made that connection? Because I mean, it's right here. Somebody says, well, you know, I never hear the Lord speak to me. Can y'all get this on video? When you call on Jesus, you're calling on the Word. Glory to God. Everything Jesus can do for you, the Word can do for you. It's one and the same. Glory to God. Did Jesus defeat the devil?
Yes. Yes.
Then the Word defeats the devil.
Yes.
Okay? Did Jesus heal sickness?
Yes.
Then the Word heals sickness. Did Jesus provide for lack? Yes. Fishes and loaves and coins in by fish's mouth, however, huh? Yes. Then the Word provides for lack.
Amen.
Same thing. How did Jesus respond to the devil's temptations in the wilderness, somebody? He said, it's written. He spoke the Word. Devil said, if you be the Son of God, turn them stones into bread. And Jesus replied, it is written. Man doesn't live by bread alone, but by every word. Somebody say every word. Every word that proceeds from the mouth of God. You think Jesus believed that, Rusty? You think that Jesus believed that man doesn't live by bread alone, but by every single word that proceeded from the mouth of God? Y'all think Jesus believed that? Oh, I know he did, because the very next thing the devil said to him, he said, if you be the Son of God, throw yourself down from this high point, because it is written that he'll give his angels charge over thee to keep thee, lest thou hit thy foot against a stone. And Jesus said, it is also written. In other words, what? Every word. Ain't it right, Coach? He said, it is written also. In other words, every word that man lives by. Thou shalt not tempt the Lord thy God. Yes, he did. See, devil quoting scriptures right there, to which Jesus responded, it is also written. Did Jesus live by every word?
Yes.
Do you? Do you live by every word? I'm going to show you something here in the book of Hebrews, a couple pages to your left, Hebrews chapter 5. Hebrews, the 5th chapter. Talking about Jesus, verse 7 says, who in the days of his flesh, when he had offered up prayers and supplications with strong crying and tears unto him that was able to save him from death, and was heard in that he feared. Sounds like the Garden of Gethsemane, kind of, doesn't it? I'm pretty sure that's what he's talking about. Could have been talking about some other times, but we know for a fact that in the Garden of Gethsemane, that kind of stuff took place. He was praying and blood became, he was sweating and it like drops of blood. You know what I'm saying? This sounds exactly like Gethsemane here. In the days of his flesh, when he had offered up prayers and supplications with strong crying and tears unto him that was able to save him from death, and was heard in that he feared. And of course, we know what his prayer was in the Garden of Gethsemane, what, don't we? Not my will be done, but what? Yours. We know that was his flesh. That's what he was praying. Oh, what he was about to face. This is the night before his crucifixion. What he was about to face wasn't pleasant. But yet, not my will be done, Lord, but yours. Can you say praise God?
Praise God.
Though he were a son. My Bible has a capital S. Though he were a son. Let me tell you, he was the son. Can you say amen?
Amen.
Though he were a son. Though he were a son, yet learned he obedience by the things which he suffered. And being made perfect, he became the author of eternal salvation unto all of them that obey him. I want to address a few things here. Verse 8 says, though he were a son, yet learned he obedience by the things which he suffered. Learned he obedience. Does that denote that there was a time when he wasn't obedient, that he had disobeyed? Well, certainly not. We know better than that, okay? And even verse 9 says, and being made perfect, he became the author of eternal salvation unto all of them that obey him. Does that, being made perfect, does that imply that perhaps there was a time when he wasn't perfect? Of course that's not what that means. So what does it mean? I'm glad you asked. I did the legwork for you. The Holy Ghost is good. Let's break this down. Verse 8, once again. Though he were a son, yet learned he obedience. Now this word learned is a word that in the Greek language simply means understand. To understand. He understood some things. Say, Jesus understood some things.
Jesus understood.
Yet learned he obedience through the things which he suffered. And this word obedience in the Greek, interesting word here. This word obedience means attentive hearing. Say that with me. Attentive hearing. Obedience. Literally, it means to hear under. The word's hupakuo. Hupakuo. It means to hear under. In other words, you are submitting yourself to that which you hear. Amen? Y'all with me? When you are being obedient, you are hearing under. It is attentive hearing that you are submitting yourself to. Amen? Y'all with me? That's the picture here of submission. He's submitting to what he hears, to what he heard. He's being obedient. Interestingly enough, the word disobey in the Greek is kind of like the word hupakuo, which means to hear under, but it's the word parakuo, which means to hear beside. To disobey means to hear beside. In other words, when you disobey what you hear, you are hearing beside. You are not hearing under, submitting yourself. In essence, you are equalizing yourself to what you hear. Hear me? Y'all hear me? You are saying, what I have to say is just as important to what you have to say. Para, like parachurch. Y'all heard the term parachurch, meaning like a church. Right? You know, oh, they go to a parent church, meaning it's not a church, but it's like a church. So it's beside a church. So when you obey, you hear under. You're submitting yourself to what you hear. When you disobey, you hear beside. In other words, you equalize yourself. You're not submitting yourself at all. You're equalizing that to yourself to that which you hear. Parakuo, hupakuo. The word obey means to hear under. So what is verse 8 saying? Let me break it down for you. Listen to me. This will help you. Because certainly Jesus never had to learn in the aspect of he didn't know some things. Certainly he didn't have to become perfect. What is it saying here? It's saying, though he were a son, okay? In other words, even though he's the Son of God, it wasn't being God that enabled him to make it through everything he went through in life, okay? He didn't call on his divine powers. The Bible tells us in one place that he emptied himself, okay, of those things when he walked the earth. He walked the earth like we do. Amen? Though he were a son, he didn't rely on being the Son of God to get through the things on earth. Watch this. Yet he learned obedience by the things he suffered. Though he were a son, he understood that submitted himself to what he heard. What did Jesus hear always? The Father, the Word. He understood that submitting himself to what he heard would get him through whatever he faced. Whatever came his way, Jesus understood that by submitting himself to what he heard, the Word, it would get him through everything. That's what that's saying. That's all that's saying. And when you think about it, of course that's what that's saying. Though he were a son, he didn't rely on being the Son of God to get through. He understood that it's the Word of God. Amen. By submitting, attentive hearing to the Word of God. Amen. By attentive hearing, by submitting himself to God, it would see him through everything life threw at him. And being made perfect. Perfect, just another way of saying, and he completed it. He finished it. He became the author of our salvation. Can you say amen?
Amen.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Jesus, who completed everything, lived a sinless life, glory to God, died on the cross, glory to God, was buried and raised up 3 days later. He became the author of eternal salvation. Can you say amen?
Amen.
Come on, church. Come on, church. Why did you tell us all that stuff that perhaps we never even cared about? Because Jesus lived in the same sinful world that you and I live in. The same world, church, where bad things happen, where there's an enemy seeking whom he may devour. Jesus went through, the Bible, the King James says, suffered. But that's just another way of saying he went through some things. Jesus went through some bad things on this earth. Hello? The Bible tells us, as a baby, they tried to kill him. As an adult, he was tempted at all points. He was talked about, lied on, laughed at, falsely accused, mocked, doubted, humiliated, beaten, scourged, crucified, murdered. Jesus went through the worst that this present age could throw at him. Yet he overcame it all, even death. Not because he was the Son of God, but because he understood that the Word of God was the answer to everything.
Amen.
He understood that the Word of God would see him through everything. Hallelujah. Verse 8 again is telling us that he understood the Word of God would get him through it all. So the Bible says, looking unto Jesus, Hebrews chapter 12, the author and finisher of our faith, who for the joy set before him endured the cross, despising the shame, and is set down at the right hand of the throne of God. In other words, he's our example. Look unto him. How did he do it? He believed and obeyed God's word. That's how he did it. Though he were a son of God, church, he was the Son of God. You are a son of God. Can you say amen?
Amen?
Are you born again? You're a son of God. Can I tell you this? That everything this world, the devil, throws at you, you can overcome it the same way he did. By the word. By the word. If you're not overcoming it, it's because you haven't applied the word. God has not stopped every bad thing from trying to ruin your life, okay? Nor has he allowed them. That's just this present world. That's just this present age we live in. How many know that's going to change one day?
Amen.
Can you say amen?
Amen.
It's coming a day when all that's going to change. But until that day, he has given you the power, his power, grace. Amen. To overcome, to use, to deal with, to be victorious in every situation that you'll find yourself. And we find that in the pages, in the promises, in the very Word of God. What Jesus understood in Hebrews chapter 5 is the same thing he told Paul in 2 Corinthians chapter 12. My grace is sufficient for you. Do you understand that this morning? It's my prayer that you do. Now stand up with me. It's my prayer that you do. That yes, bad things happen in this day we live in. It just does. Okay? But as a child of God, you need not let it overcome you. God's given you grace, and it's more than enough. You might say, well, how do I get on that? The Bible tells us. The Bible tells us everything. Because of sin, a man is lost. But it tells us how to become unlost. You're saved by how? By grace, through faith. That not of your own. It's the gift of God, not of works, that any man should boast. It tells us. Whatever you're facing in life, you can overcome it. It does not have to sink you. But the only way you can receive God's grace into your life is you have to believe it. I say faith.
Amen.
How does faith come?
Amen.
Hearing the word. Hearing the word. Hearing the word. Not just hearing it, but believing it. For he who comes to God, Hebrews 11, 6, must believe that he is and that he's a rewarder of those that diligently seek him. In other words, that he's going to do what he said he was going to do. That when he said he'll heal you, he'll heal you. When he said he'll save you, he'll save you. When he said he'll deliver you, he'll deliver you. It's good. All the time. And all the time. Father, if there be one here today who doesn't know you as Lord and Savior, I thank you that Titus said that the grace of God has appeared unto all men unto salvation. In other words, salvation is freely offered to every person on the face of this earth. But you got to accept it. You got to receive it into your own life. If you're here today and you've never made Jesus Christ the Lord of your life,
Won't you accept that? The Bible says faith comes by hearing. You've heard that it's yours. Believe that. Receive that. If you're here today and you're in the fight, you're in the struggle, glory to God. God has promised that you can overcome if you will apply His word into your life. You can overcome everything that this enemy, he's going about seeking whom he may devour. He's looking for somebody that he can get to. Stand on the word of God. Proclaim, he can't get to me. No weapon formed against me. Oh, they may form something up against you, but it won't prosper. It won't succeed. It won't prevail. My God will never leave me nor forsake me. My God always causes me to triumph in Christ Jesus. Stuff happens. Don't you go with the flow. You rise above. You overcome. Paul said, I sought the Lord 3 times about this. Paul was a great man. Paul had some revelation. But Paul was just a man. He wasn't Jesus. The Bible put it right out there. And Jesus said, look, my grace is sufficient for you. Deal with it. You know what Paul said? Oh, okay. He's putting it out there for you today. I don't know what all you're going through. I'm sure many are going through something. Usually everybody's going through something to some degree. I know this, that God's able to keep that which I've committed to Him. Glory to God. What have you committed to Him today? Hallelujah. Father, I thank you for it today. The grace of God, the power of God, the ability of God. Hallelujah. Moving in this service today, saving souls, healing bodies, setting the captive free. Whatever's needed today, I thank you that is provided for by the grace of God. And I thank you that faith rises up and grabs a hold of it in this service this morning. Father, that nobody would leave discouraged or without hope, glory to God, but they would be encouraged, Lord God, and strengthened from on high today. The Bible says that faith is the very substance of things hoped for. It's what you want. It's what it is, glory to God. It's what it provides. I thank you for it in Jesus' name. Glory to God. If I can pray with you, I want to pray with you. If you need prayer, I want to pray with you. My wife and I believe God with you. Glory to God. I believe God. Hallelujah. She believes the Lord. Amen. Hallelujah. Two or three witnesses going and have that thing established, have that thing manifest in your life. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. So look at your neighbor saying, good gosh. That's... Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Get that CD. We're going to make that CD. Get that CD and just go over it and over it and over it. Because the Lord is good. The Lord speak to you. Amen?
Amen.
Say this with me. I'm strong in the Lord. I am more than a conqueror. I'm blessed and healed by the Christ of Jesus. I have the greater one living in me. I can do all things in Christ who strengthens me. Why? Because of God's grace. Amen. And I believe it.
Amen.
Amen.
Amen.